a child was with us, a boy was 11 years old, and one Saturday he called the social worker. He said, "My mommy and daddy are fighting again." Then the social worker said, "Go to a corner and just be safe there. I'll be there in 30 minutes. The social worker walks into the home. Gate was open, mother and son was there, talked to them. After a few minutes, the father walks in. He turns to the social worker and says, "Do you know where I've been? Just now, my son turned to me and said, 'Dad, I think you need to go downstairs and walk and regulate yourself.'"
Wow.
Hi everybody, my name is Isaac, an ex-offender and also currently host for Flip the Prata. Together I have...
I'm Frederick and I'm with Architects of Life, a social enterprise that actually strives to transform ex-offenders from stereotypes to archetypes.
Exactly. Yeah. We have our guests here with us today, Emaniel and Kee Hong. Kee Hong, you introduce yourself.
My name is Kee Hong and I'm the head of home of Chen Methodist Children's Home.
And Emaniel?
I'm Emaniel.
Emaniel?
Yeah, Emaniel.
Yeah, welcome guys.
Yeah, we're so happy to have you on the show.
Yep.
So maybe, Kee Hong, can you tell us more about Chen Su Lan Children's Home and what...
What do you guys do?
It's very interesting because it's the first time I'm meeting a director from a children's home. And I'm just wondering, like, what were your motivations behind even coming to this arena of helping, you know, children?
This home has been around for 55 years.
55 years?
Based on that name, Chen Su Lan, there was a doctor in the pioneer batch of Singapore, the first batch of doctors, who graduated from University of Malaya. He made a very interesting promise to himself and to God. He said, "God, I'm gonna make sure I serve you." And
to that is a children's home.
No. He became a doctor and he was all absorbed being a doctor in Singapore. And Japanese war came. Very quickly, he ran away from Singapore on a ship, shipwrecked, and he was floating off Singapore. And he said, "God, sorry, I didn't fulfill my promise, but if you let me live, I will go back and fulfill my promise." Hence, he started the opium-free clinic.
Okay.
And then he started YWCA. And then he also became the founding, the funds that started this home 55 years ago with Wesley Methodist Church. Because they realized at that time there were a lot of children who were neglected, abused, that nobody was helping with.
Yep.
So that started as a little bungalow in Changi Beach at the time.
And it was donated through the church?
Donated through the Chen Su Lan Trust and the Wesley Methodist Church.
Yeah. Okay. And right now, you're still staying true to your mission, like to help this group of children?
Yeah, after 55 years, it's grown from a place where there are 15 kids to a place where there are 80 to 90 children.
80 to 90 children?
Yeah. And we're only one of 19 homes in Singapore licensed to take in children who are either abused or neglected, severely abused or neglected, from what we call unsafe family contacts. And they will stay in these homes anywhere from a year to sometimes 15 years.
15 years.
Yeah.
So how long have you been with Chen Su Lan Children's Home?
Actually, my relationship is about 10 years, although I've only been the head of home for 4. Before that, I was the board member that's led how to take over the running of the home. And prior to that, I was the volunteer counselor and chaplain. But that was the time when I was working in church. So
when we go moving on to Emaniel, tell us a little bit about yourself. Like, what was your story?
I've been Boys Home and Grace 7 Hostel.
Grace 7 Hostel.
Yes.
And so there's a hostel and then there's a Boys Home. What's the difference?
Hostel, you have more freedom and you don't have so much rules and regulations and you get to go outside school. They don't have an inside school, you know. For Boys Home, you have to study inside and you rarely get to book out unless you really behave, like, you know. So that's very different.
It's like prison, would you say?
Prison totally can't go out.
So at least you still get home leave and all this kind of thing.
Yeah.
Oh.
So what was your journey like? Like, was it like hostel first and Boys Home or?
So I actually went in Boys Home 3 weeks after I got sentenced. Then I went 1 year into hostel. then followed by 3 months tagging afterwards, then I got into a fresh, like a new case, and I went into boys home for 2 years. So that's how the journey has.
3 weeks, so that's your first sentence.
Yes.
And after hostel, was it a sentence?
It was continuous, the 3 weeks and 1 year hostel and tagging.
Oh.
Yeah, and probation.
So it's like a step down at the hostel.
Yes, so it's a step down.
Okay, okay.
Mm. And I understand that Kee Hong also yourself on the side, you do some work with ex-offenders and, you know, recovering drug addicts.
Yeah, I have been involved in prison work for a little over 20 years.
Mm.
Previously, I call it in care, that means in the prison itself, and after that, it's aftercare. So half of it is aftercare.
And aftercare means like halfway houses?
Aftercare is halfway houses, and aftercare, that means ex-prisoners or prisoners' families and ex-prisoners who've been released. Because rebuilding lives in Singapore is not an easy road to take.
But so what's the difference between a hostel and a home? I mean,
a children's home is a place where children are placed somewhere safe.
Right.
Singapore girls' home and Singapore boys' home are structured facilities where you, as Emmanuel had said, it's not a place where you have a lot of freedom. Mm. Let's assume that this is now 5 o'clock and it's so-called recreation time.
Okay.
And I wanted to play basketball. Now, Emmanuel, if it's 5 o'clock basketball, what would you have to do?
Like you mean in boys' home?
Yes.
You can't.
You can't.
Oh, you can't?
You can't.
You can't come out.
It's structured time, right?
It's structured and everything is planned.
One day, I think you only have like 30 minutes yard time. They call it yard time.
30 minutes yard time?
Have 30
so
minutes.
The word yard times comes from where?
Prison.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, yeah.
So in other words, it's when I say structured, it's just a gentle word saying your whole life is very tightly managed.
Okay. Mm. Even your movements.
Every movement. Oh. Every movement.
I mean, I was from DRC, like Drug Rehabilitation Center. It was in Selarang. So, I mean, the policy has changed to rehab drug offenders, not as criminals in Changi Prison, but as a rehabilitation. So,
yes.
In Selarang was open air. It's not like Changi where it's so close. So, I mean, they say it's to foster a conducive environment.
4 gates versus 12 gates.
Yes, exactly.
I remember.
Wait. What's this 4 gates versus 12 gates thing? Like, can you explain further?
From the entrance to the room where you meet a group of men to hold a class, hold a session. Selarang is 4 gates to get there.
I see.
Changi is 12 gates to get there.
Wow.
12 controlled gates.
Okay, so this means that Selarang is like something like a low security. Changi is like super max.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's more rehabilitation center than which is true because
that's 8.
Oh, boys home is 8. Wow, so boys home is actually pretty high security as well, higher than...
Very high.
So, I mean, asking Kee Hong, do you see people like your boys, you know, or even the people you work with, the children you work with, having dreams and hopes?
They do. In fact, you're talking about what we are doing in our home. Because we have about 7 different services. I call it added services around children's life. So when you mention art, we have art therapies in our home on a department of counselors, psychologists, and art therapists. So through art therapy sessions, the boys and girls discover that they might have a knack, a gift for art. Although it's a healing and therapeutic process, but there's also a learning process there. Let's take another example. What if you're like me when I was young, all I'm interested is sports. I don't care about grades, I don't care about anything, and I do have boys like that.
Yeah.
So what do you do with a boy who doesn't care about his failing grades and anything else in life? So for us, the other added service is that try him out on sports.
Right.
Try him on badminton, basketball, ping pong, you know.
Alternative paths.
Yeah. And if he develops an interest,
right,
then we bring in experts and train him up. So we train children in music,
that's
singing.
Amazing.
So we hire these extra services to into the home to train these children in areas and develop their potential talents.
Mm. So actually in Chen Su Lan, it's more like y'all don't really have a very strict schedule, so to speak, but it's more like letting the children explore different avenues.
No, if you say not so strict, I see the picture of them just walking as freely. No, it's still a structured life. But it's all customized to each child's needs. Wow. So in other words, we look at a child, we have 80 children. Every child, we look at a child and say, what's the desired outcome for him or her? Right. Because based on the trauma, how do we need to help them heal and then develop them?
Because they need more attention and you're looking at it from a holistic perspective and not just like putting them through school and then see what comes out of it or what course they choose.
So like what Emmanuel said, in children's homes, all children go to your normal schools or special schools. Right. Because there's no in-house.
Okay.
In the we don't do homeschooling, right? So when they come back from school, they will have to go to education center. They may have to go to therapy. They may go to recreation. They may go to music or art. So we help the children to develop all their different interests. So there was two boys in fact, who were just like that. No interest in anything, but the moment they were only 11 and we helped them, the staff would spend half an hour individually with them playing basketball until they say, hey, I'm quite good at it.
And you develop passion
for
them.
Two of them became school team players.
Cool.
And for the first time, you could see the change in the personality. They found self-worth.
Yes.
Mm.
One, I'm in a children's home, so I'm very quiet in school because I'm ashamed that I'm taken away from my parents. My classmates don't want to talk about my parents because they won't show up at the parents' day, right? Because they may be incarcerated or they can't be bothered.
Yeah.
So when a vehicle picks them up, they also don't want to be identified with a van because, look at him, he's going to go to a children's home.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of shame and low self-worth. But when you help a child develop his or her interest, we have now girls and boys who can sing, can dance, can play drums, can play guitar, you know, can do draw art. So they finally found a self-worth.
And from that,
then they realize, okay, I will now do my homework because I need that.
Okay.
You know. So usually when they find their self-worth, they finally find a reason for improving their grades.
Wow, I like to direct this, Emmanuel. Like, you know, as a children who has been through the system yourself, right? How do you feel about whatever he shared, you know? Do you go through about?
Yeah, actually I did go through about all this. So during my hostel days, right? After when you end school, you come back, every Thursday they will have soccer, like football, then you will have coaches to teach you. So if you're good, then they will might add you to their team and go and like competition, all those, this and that. And then we have Bible class. I don't think that's something that will help us, but we have Bible class also.
not everybody.
Is it a Christian one?
It's a Christian home. So we have Bible class also. And sometimes the staff also will play basketball with us.
Mm.
Or they will bring us out and, you know,
USS
or whatsoever, something like that. Yeah.
Not everybody would find their passion through that, right?
Mm.
Did you manage to ignite something in you, or I mean, be honest, like it's fine.
Yeah. I mean, actually, the games that we play all inside, right, is majority voted.
Voted.
Yes.
So the majority.
So the majority of us, we will choose sports. Then the staff will say, hey, maybe this Thursday we can have something. You guys vote what you guys want. So maybe like 2-3 months, they will come back to this question. Okay, you all can vote what you want. As long as within the budget, the hostel they can provide us, they will give us as long as they can afford it.
Mm.
But if they can't, then they will find alternative ways. Maybe some staff, because there are staff that are youth worker.
Oh.
So maybe they have that some experience in that. So they will like...
So they facilitate.
Yeah, they facilitate. Okay, okay. They will like supervise us. Yes. Yeah.
So is there like one youth worker assigned to you personally, or do you report to anyone?
Don't have.
Okay.
Okay. It's more like just I don't know because I've never been to boys' home, you see. So like how is it like living inside? Like who takes care of you? Or
okay, so boys' home, right? Every few dorms, they call it dorms, right? Every few dorms there's like staff in charge.
Okay.
So they don't in charge of you personally, but they're in charge of like a few dorms. So if you have like any issues, like you don't have like soap or you need paper or anything like that, you have raised up to them, then they will get it done for you.
So more like, okay, so let's say, I mean, they always say, okay, for me, when I come from prison, right, I have a counselor, I have some will have social worker, I have a RO, a reintegration officer, and then you will get your family. So these are the support net that they will come, that after prison, they give so that, you know, you are stable outside. But for boys' home, like when you're inside and then coming out, like what's the support structure in place?
Okay, so when you're inside, right, they will give you a social worker. Okay. There was a social worker like maybe twice a week. And I mean, twice they will come and visit you once. So they will talk to you and ask you how was your day, everything, and anything you want to raise up or anything. And then you will have psychologists also. They will come and talk to you once in a while. If they think that you're totally fine, there's no need for them to see you again, then they won't see you.
Okay. So all when, the way until you are released.
Yes. So after when you release really, right, of course the staff inside the social worker belongs to the home itself. They don't in charge you, take care of you afterwards, right? So MSF, they will send another person to replace that social worker that you will have inside.
Sounds like a lot of support in place.
If you were to enter boys' home, right, you will have a probation officer also. So that's the another person that you can speak to other than the social worker.
Do you find that it's comfortable for you to speak with them?
Definitely, because you don't have to tell them your history, don't have to tell them how naughty you are. Because everything is in the report.
Okay.
They can just read through, this guy did something like that, or whatever. They interview the parents know that, this guy, he at home, how is he like, and everything. So whenever you want to say something, just say to her then he will like, okay, we'll see what we can do.
And I want to ask Emmanuel, like, how was your family, like, your growing up years, like, you know, were that really influenced your formative years? And how did the home change that?
Normal, like how usual kids will grow up. Just that things that I may want, they cannot provide. So I will tend to do things to get what I want, like stealing or whatsoever. Then life has always been like that. And then back then they were working, because my parents are quite young. So back then they were working, they didn't really have time for... I have a brother and a sister, they didn't really have time for us.
You're the youngest?
Yes, I'm the youngest.
And your parents are working?
Yes, both of them are working and didn't really have time for us. So we actually have a maid. So most of the time, the time that I spend, right, is always with the maid. Not with my parents or whatsoever.
I mean, growing up here also.
Yeah.
Maybe I chime in with the question you had. So when the social workers appeared in the family context, did your parents appreciate their presence?
No. They find it irritating and they find it, because of you, I need to go down early in the morning to see the social worker, and because of you, I need to
That's so interesting.
I have to take off day, spend one off day just to meet one social worker for 2 hours. After that, my whole off day ruined. I could have done that to do something else, you know.
Thank you for that, because you've touched on an area that's very challenging in social work. Imagine, in my home, 80 children, everyone has been removed from their families because of severe abuse and neglect. So how do you think parents feel? The last thing they want to talk to is the social worker me or any of my staff.
Who removed them from the home itself.
Correct. So you're not their friend, you're their enemy.
Wow.
And yet we strive to work with parents and say, look, we're really not your enemy. We want to reunify your child with you, but... You gotta let us help
you. Give us
a
reason to.
You gotta let us help you. So there's always, fortunately, a percentage of parents who are willing to work with us and say, okay, what else do I need to do? But I fully understand and can empathize with his parents' response to the social worker, because he said, kacau mi, you're the one who took the child away, then you want to teach me how to live my life. You know? So that's how most of them would think. Don't bother me. And that's very painful. All my children were abused, neglected. How do I put them back in an environment where the parents have not really changed their minds? Right. I've done my best. I put food on the table. What are you talking about, right? So it doesn't make sense to them, nor do they have the time to engage.
So it's this whole dilemma where you're trying to help the child, but you also at the same time have to help the parents.
Yeah, so you can't force feed a change, right? So how do you bring that about with a great patience? That means you engage them, you earn their trust, and let them see if eventually we're really on your side. Look, see how the child changed. So for example, there was one time, a child was with us, a boy was 11 years old, And one Saturday, he called the social worker. He said, "My mommy and daddy are fighting again." Then the social worker said, "Go to a corner and just be safe there. I'll be there in 30 minutes. The social worker walks into the home. Gate was open. Mother and son was there, talked to them. After a few minutes, the father walks in. He turns to the social worker and says, "Do you know where I've been? Just now, my son turned to me and said, 'Dad, I think you need to go downstairs and walk and regulate yourself.'"
Wow. 11 years
old. Yeah. And 6 months with us. So the father confessed that after I heard it, no choice lah. I go downstairs and walk lah.
Oh my goodness.
And it happened.
Yeah.
And that boy was only with us for that we have taught him that, look, if you lose control of yourself, you need to regulate yourself because you got angry, you got frustrated, but that's not the reaction because the outcome is not good.
I'm actually so happy to hear that at the age of 11, right, you're able to speak with such maturity. I guess being exposed to the therapist.
Unfortunately, not every child would have that. Yeah. But there's a lot of positive stories
all
that come out of
all this one shining light gives you the meaning that you have in your work. And it's also like when the father sees that and then it kind of short circuits his mind, like, oh, why is my child saying
so for that, we earn their trust, isn't it?
Exactly.
Another situation, the boy has been with us also about half a year. Suddenly, the parents showed up on home visit and said to the social worker, because we usually observe their visitation time. In terms of social worker, he said, "What happened to my son?" He said, "Wait, what happened?" He said, "He comes home, he now sweeps floor, mop floor, want to help me. Can I send my two other younger children to you?"
Wow.
Because we teach them the basics of social skills and all that. You have to keep clean, tidy your cupboard. And you know, when people visit us, they look at the cupboard, they say, "Oh, you prepared for our visit?" Say, no.
Like stand by bed.
Stand by bed. Perfect, orderly, 80%, not all. Yeah. And we said, no, we are not doing it for you. We help them we teach them to keep it tidy and neat every day. Yeah, so the beds are like a stand by bed standard.
So I think to wrap up, right, I'm going to ask Emaniel, what is one thing that you would like to say to other boys like you, maybe, who identify with you?
Well, actually, this is a very hard question there, because 12 years old, you don't have much friends that can guide you a good way. Your parents, if it's not helping you, that will be very difficult. And if you don't know there's MSF, you wouldn't even look for them. Well, I think if my 12-year-old self, I think...
It's alright, you can take some time to think about it. But I think, I just find it so interesting that, all four of us, we all come from very different, like, we have Emaniel from Boys Home, Boys Hostel, we have Kee Hong from Chen Su Lan Children's Home, you know. We have Isaac Goh, who has, he himself, XO from DRC, and myself from the Halfway House system. So it's like, there's a whole circle or spectrum of people that are from different organizations and different stages. Yeah. So I would say that there are many avenues that you can seek help for when you are at different stages in life. I think especially when the younger stage, maybe there are children homes like Chen Su Lan, you know. For DRC stage, there are organizations like Architects of Life,
like WeCare, other addiction specialists.
And also for like ex-offenders and for even like homeless alcoholics or even teenage delinquents, there are places like halfway houses, you know, like The Hiding Place or New Caris Mission, which are actually open, or they have certain criteria, but they are open to sheltering these kind of people. Yeah, so I think it's very interesting that, you know, we have everyone like from the...
Yeah, we've all been through the system. Yes. Like either we are on the other side of the system or we are beneficiaries of the system.
Yes.
But it's not only the system that gives us the avenue to change. There are some people who there are many support systems out there, especially in Singapore, like Keong said. We're so blessed to be in Singapore. Final thing you would like to add?
Actually, the parting word would be this. Whoever is hearing and seeing this, I would say please, you can be someone who can open your eyes and ears to what's happening around you, whether in your family, relatives, or even neighbors. If there's any trace of abuse or neglect, raise it up. You're not betraying anyone. You're actually helping a child, usually children, to not suffer anymore. So just be on the lookout. If there's anything at all, just raise it up to MSF. Just one phone call will do, and somebody will investigate. It's not as though that one phone call causes somebody to go to prison. Not necessarily. Most of the time, they don't go to prison. Most of the time, we want to rehabilitate the family, but we got to make sure these children are in safe places. Mm. And only your eyes and ears can help minimize that.
Is there like a hotline business that they can call?
Actually, everybody has a phone. Yes. Ping, you can go for so many different lines of help in Singapore. Mm. Just be on the lookout, you know. So help the rest of your neighbors and friends.
Give the voice to the voices.
To minimize the to help eradicate and minimize.
Any parting words from you?
So to the question that you all asked me earlier on, right?
Yeah.
I think if I was 12 years old and I would tell myself is that if I cannot talk to my parents or I don't know there's MSF or anything like that going on or those, right, I will try to go and speak to someone that I think are not so bad. Maybe they can guide me along the way, that they can tell me what's right and what's wrong. Or maybe I can seek help from my sibling, like my brother, okay, maybe not my brother, maybe my sister, yeah.
Chopio is quite tough, you're still in the safe space.
It's quite tough lah. So I can say lot to the parents, if their kid is 12 years old, make sure that they keep an eye on them, or because at 12 years old, you don't know what they're thinking, what they feel, or maybe the care is not enough to really go and understand what they're going through.
Anything you'd like to tell everybody who is watching?
I mean, if I can stand here today and sit here and talk to you guys, means I walked through all this and then I never give up and I'm still here. So no reason for them to, you know, for you guys to give up, you know.
No need to have big dreams, yes. No need to have big goals or
as long
high
as
expectations for yourself.
You can survive, you can take care of your family, your parents, that's enough really.
And sometimes that's all that matters, right?
Yes.
Yep.
We don't need to be entrepreneurs, we don't need to be idols or famous people. Mm. We just make a difference in our own ways. Like yourself and Kee Hong and ourselves doing our work at Architects of Life. Oh, it's been great meeting all of you, and thank you so much for sharing, both of you. You'd like to say anything?
Yeah, I think I just want to thank Kee Hong and Emaniel for coming down to the talk show. I think it's been a pleasure to have you all on the show.
Yeah, really insightful sharing by both of you.
It was a good time. May I just add 5 words?
Yes. Sure.
Speak up to stop abuse.
Okay, wow.
Thank you for tuning in to Flip the Prata, and catch you again next time.
Alright, see you!
See you!
Bye!